continue with our discussion on frequency compressive feedback that we started last time. I hope you recollect the basic idea. We just introduced the block diagram at that stage, and the block diagram looks something like this. You have the incoming FM signal here. This is followed by a multiplier and a bandpass filter. So this is slightly different from what we have in a phase lock loop, where the multiplier is followed by low pass filter, so that this combination acts like a phase detector. Even now it more or less will do a very similar thing, except that the difference signal will not be a baseband signal, but will be a signal at the difference frequency between the incoming signal frequency and the VCO frequency. The VCO frequency is tuned not to omega C, but to is somewhat offset from omega C to some other carrier frequency omega 0, right. So there is an offset by an amount of omega 0, so that the difference frequency here is omega 0, right. So this passes through this band pass filter, and as we will argue today, at the output of this band pass filter we have the we again will have some kind of an FM signal present here, right. What kind of FM signal, we will try to see that. So that to demodulate we require a discriminator, right, and the discriminator output is fed to the VCO to close the loop. So the essential difference between the phase lock loop and the frequency compressive feedback system here is that the VCO is offset from the incoming signal frequency by an amount omega 0, right, and as a consequence the filter following the multiplier is not a low pass filter, but a filter tuned to omega 0, the amount by which the VCO is offset, right. Now how does this help? To start the analysis of this, to understand how it works or what it is able to do for us, consider the received signal as a signal of this kind. A sub c cosine omega c t plus phi of t, where phi of t denotes your modulation, right. Then the VCO output here we say would be, let us say, a sub v sine of omega c minus omega naught t plus some phase modulation theta of t, right, where once again the phase modulation will be dependent on the input signal here, right. That is, for example, in a VCO we know that the model is that the instantaneous frequency is proportional to the input voltage, right. So the model for theta t is the usual VCO model. Theta t is, let us say, some constant k sub v integral of e sub v t dt, or right, where k v is the VCO constant. So all the expressions are same, except that the VCO output is not at omega c, but omega c minus omega naught. So what happens to, let us call this signal, the signal at the multiplier output, as e sub dt, okay, signal here. So what will be the nature of this signal e sub dt? You multiply x sub rt and e naught t, it will be a cosine into sine term, and there will be some component and there will be difference frequency component. So e sub dt becomes half of a sub c a sub v, some component will be sine of 2 omega c minus omega naught t plus phi of t plus theta of t, right. This is the sum argument, and the difference argument will be minus half a sub c a sub v sine of omega 0 t plus phi of t minus theta of t. this is straightforward application of trigonometric activities. So what will be the band pass filter output? The band pass filter output will be proportional to this quantity. Well, it will be basically the second term, right? Because that is at frequency omega 0. The first term 2 omega c minus omega 0 is at a much higher frequency and will be removed by the band pass filter. Therefore, if I look at the phase deviation at the input of the discriminator, what can we say about that? The phase deviation is really now this part, phi of t minus theta t. It's not either phi of t or theta of t. It's the difference between these two. Which is it? What it was in the case of PLL also, except for this term, right? Now let's look at this quantity, phi of t minus theta t. Theta t is from here k sub v integral e sub v alpha d alpha minus infinity to t. This is being followed by a discriminator, and what would the discriminator do here? This discriminator was not present in the PLL, right? Instead of a discriminator, at most we had a loop filter, right? So we have a discriminator here, and what is the job of a discriminator? It produces an output voltage proportional to the input frequency deviation, right? Instantaneous input frequency deviation. So we have the output e sub vt, output is e sub vt, output of the discriminator is let us say 1 by 2 pi the constant k sub d, which is the discriminator constant, into d by dt of the incoming phase deviation, right, which is phi of t minus k sub v integral e v alpha d alpha, right. If you were to continue this manipulation, so this will become e sub dt as 1 by 2 pi k sub d d phi by dt minus 1 by 2 pi k sub d k sub v e v t. Sorry, this should be e v t, my mistake. The left hand side is also e sub v t, right? That is what it was. Just continuing on the next sheet, you can move this e v t, e sub v t to the left and solve for e sub v t, right. So if I do that, I will get e sub v t as 1 by 2 pi k sub d upon 1 plus 1 by 2 pi k sub d k sub v into d phi by dt, okay. That is quite obvious. Take this onto the left hand side, combine these two terms, solve for e sub v t, this is what you will get. Let me write this as, in terms, what is d phi by dt? D phi by dt is the instantaneous frequency deviation of the input FM signal, which is going to be proportional to the message signal, right. So this becomes k sub d k sub f upon 1 plus 1 by 2 pi k v k d mt. So therefore the demodulation is done, the output is proportional to mt as we would like, right. This is a constant, so the output is proportional to mt. Here I have taken the FM constant to be, FM modulator constant to be 2 pi kf, right. It is a the units are slightly different from what we have been considering so far. So therefore it is clear that the system, this frequency compressive feedback system, works as an FM demodulator. What is the big question here? That it works is fine, but what is the big question here? There is a certain kind of question that arises here, that if you are going to have a discriminator here anyway, you might as well have just the discriminator, and that will produce your FM output. So what have you achieved? No, to see that, let us go through some more mathematics, a little bit of more mathematics, to understand why it helps, or why is it useful to do the way we have just done it, is to try to rewrite the try to write an expression for xt, where xt I am defining this signal here, signal at the discriminator input, right. We just said that the signal here is basically due to this term, right. The signal here is due to the difference term, the signal at the input, and there the instantaneous phase has this form, phi of t minus theta of t, where theta t is this, right. Let us try to understand this a little more. So let us write down an expression for x t. X t is this expression. So x t is a signal at the discriminator input, right. Let us see what kind of signal do we have at the discriminator input. It is minus half a sub c a sub v sine of omega 0 t plus, let me substitute for this quantity, okay, let me first write it like this, plus phi of t minus k v okay, nothing new there. Okay, I want to simplify this. Is there a way to simplify this? Any suggestions for that? Look at this. We just got this expression for EVT. What was it? EVT was 1 by 2 pi k sub d upon 1 plus 1 by 2 pi k sub v k sub d d phi by dt, right. So if I integrate this, what do I get? I essentially get this constant times phi of t. You already have phi of t, so the two together can be expressed in terms of phi of t. What will it be? Phi of t into 1 minus this constant, right. So this argument, which I have underlined here, can be written as phi of t minus the integral of this, which is, let me just rewrite this constant as some k into phi of t, where k denotes this constant. If I carry out the subtraction, this becomes 1 upon 1 plus 1 by 2 pi k v k d phi of t, right, just a simple algebraic manipulation. Any questions on this? 1 minus capital K is basically this constant, right, because this I am writing as phi of t into 1 minus capital K, where capital K is this constant. You carry out the subtraction, you get this. So therefore, this expression for the signal x t becomes minus half a sub c a sub v sine of omega 0 t, and the term phi t minus theta t becomes 1 upon 1 plus 1 by 2 pi k sub v k sub d phi of t. Okay. Now that is the point at which we can try to gain some understanding or insight into what we are achieving here. What was your input FM signal like? Your input FM signal was similar, except that you had omega CT here, some other carrier frequency, plus phi T. This constant was missing, right? You had omega CT plus phi T. So the FM signal at the input, or the PM signal at the input, was this plus phi T. Of course, we have a different carrier frequency, but the carrier frequency is of no consequence, but the because the discriminator will be designed to operate at the carrier frequency of the input signal. If you had directly used the discriminator, your discriminator would have been designed around omega C, right? Since you are using the discriminator inside the loop, this discriminator would be working around the frequency omega 0, that is your band pass differentiator would be around omega 0, right? But it is the same discriminator, except that the range of frequencies which it operates on is different, right? But the important point is this constant. What is the nature of this constant? Is it a very small quantity or a very large quantity? It is a small quantity, because typically we can choose very large values of kV and kD, and typically it will be done. So what we are doing essentially is multiplying the incoming phase by a small number, right? Now what does that mean? That means the discriminator that we are going to design for use within the loop has to work with a narrow band FM signal rather than a broad band FM signal, right? So even if the input signal is a broad band FM signal, because of this division here of phi t by some small constant, it converts that broad band signal into effectively a narrow band signal, or a signal with a smaller value of the modulation index beta, right? So if you choose large values of the two constants here, that is the product k sub d into k sub v is large, the phase deviation can be made small. So this reduces the bandwidth of the signal at the discriminator input. Right? Effectively it reduces the modulation index. Modulation index, of course, one talks about only for a sinusoidal modulating signal in this case, right? So in general, basically it converts this broadband signal into a narrow band signal. That is what I mean by reduces the bandwidth at the input to the discriminator. Why should that be important for demodulation? It is not obvious at all. How does it help us? Now unfortunately the details of this I cannot discuss with you right now, but let me just mention something which I mentioned earlier. This has to do with a peculiar characteristic in the demodulation of FM signals, right? Particularly when you are dealing with noisy input signals, right? I mentioned this earlier very briefly. The FM signal, FM system works extremely well in noisy conditions, provided the signal is considerably larger than noise, right? Provided the signal to noise ratio is above a certain threshold value. However, it is interesting to note, we will discuss how that happens later, because we are not right now discussing the performance against noise. As we do that, we will appreciate that the FM signal actually becomes very bad when the input noisy conditions become very bad, right? So instead of a graceful degradation as the noise increases, which is what we would normally expect any good system to work with, to behave like, you know, as the input signal becomes worse, the output also will become worse, but usually we would expect systems to have graceful degradation. As the input signal degrades in quality, the output also should degrade in quality, proportionately. FM does not behave like that. It behaves extremely well when the input signal is good, that is the signal to noise ratio is good. But the moment the signal to noise ratio becomes smaller than that some threshold value, it starts to behave extremely badly. The system almost breaks down, right. That is why this phenomenon is called threshold effect, and it is advised to use FM always above the threshold value, right. The signal to noise ratio should be maintained to be larger than some threshold value, right. So, this threshold effect is something we will discuss in more detail when we discuss effect of noise later, but this is an important fact of life when we consider FM. Now, this effect is more pronounced, this threshold effect that I have just discussed is more pronounced for wideband FM than for narrowband FM. Okay. And that immediately gives us the motivation for going for this circuit, right, because the discriminator here is working with a narrowband FM signal. So, the effect is the implication is that it will be less sensitive, it will be less prone to threshold effect than the discriminator which would have had to operate on the wideband input FM signal directly, right. So, this is a real advantage of going for frequency compressive feedback, that is to reduce the incoming wideband FM signal to a narrowband FM signal for which the threshold effect is less pronounced. What do I mean by the threshold effect is less pronounced? Means that the input signal can be basically the threshold is lowered, the value of the threshold SNR at which it degrades disproportionately becomes smaller, right. So, in a way we carry out a kind of threshold extension using the frequency compressive feedback system. The threshold is moved to the left, right. Let me just let us try to argue this out pictorially. Any system, any communication system, if you have to plot, I mean we have not yet done this analysis, output SNR versus input SNR, SNR stands for signal to noise ratio, right, signal power to noise power ratio. Typically the behavior would be like this: as the input SNR is decreased, the output SNR would decrease, that is expected, right. There will be some SNR gain depending on what kind of system you have, right, but the output SNR will obviously decrease if the input SNR decreases. There is nothing wrong with that because that is likely to happen. This will happen for example in AM, this will happen in FM. But what happens in FM additionally, which is what I am talking about now, that as long as input SNR is above some value, you will find that this output SNR is very good, it will be much more than what you could get in an AM system, right. But the moment it falls below some value, let us say this value, if the input SNR falls below this value, instead of degrading gracefully like this, which is what would have been a good thing to do, it suddenly starts to behave like this. The output SNR becomes much smaller than the linear decrease that I have shown here, right. So, that is the threshold effect, and this SNR at which it happens is called the threshold SNR, that is you have to maintain the input SNR above this value, right. It is therefore desirable that the value of this threshold SNR should be as low as possible, right, and that is what we are trying to do. By working with narrowband FM discrimination rather than wideband FM discrimination, even though you are transmitting a wideband FM signal, you are trying to move this threshold point to the left, right, so that instead of this behavior starting here, it may start here, and you have this margin by which you have carried out threshold extension, right. That is the purpose of this system. So, that is the main advantage of frequency compressive feedback. So, the in one line the advantage is it extends the threshold point, to the left. However, I'm only making a statement here because I'm not true to any of these things that I've mentioned here, right? At this point, we cannot do that, right? But that's the main advantage. Let's take it from here right now. Any questions? Both the phase lock loop and the frequency compressive feedback system essentially help us to do this, carry out the threshold extension that I have just mentioned. All right, so that brings us to the end of discussion of FM demodulation using feedback circuits. We discussed two feedback circuits, the phase lock loop and the frequency compressive feedback, right. Both have similar working principles, but they differ in detail, which is what we discussed. Now let's look at the performance of FM signals. I'm not yet ready to discuss the performance of any kind of modulation signals in the presence of noise, because we need to build our background about describing noise, right? Because noise, unlike the signals that we are dealing with normally, are non-deterministic signals. So I don't have yet the necessary I haven't yet developed in the class the necessary background that is required to discuss the performance of all these systems in the presence of noise. Noise is a very, very important phenomenon that every communication engineer has to deal with, right? Communications is broadly made difficult because of the presence of noise, right? Various kinds of noise, which we have discussed long time ago. However, it is possible to get a feel for how the system performance will be even without knowing how to characterize noise, right? And that is by looking at the situation of deterministic kind of interference, which we did, for example, also for the case of AM signal, if you remember, right? We discussed what happens if there is a nearby carrier to the AM signal and it gets through your RF and IF filters, right? The image frequency comes in the form of a signal which is close to your actual carrier frequency, right? And it comes in, so it becomes a kind of interference. And we saw what happens in the case of AM. What happened? There also there was a kind of threshold effect, if you noticed, particularly for the envelope detector. For the synchronous detector, there was no problem, right? There was a graceful degradation, but for the envelope detector, as long as the input signal to interference ratio was large, right, the output was similar to the input signal, except that the interference was proportional to the input interference. Output interference was proportional to the amount of input interference. However, the moment the interference became very large, if you remember, what happened? The output became totally different, right? It had no resemblance to the input. So even without considering noise, one can get an intuitive feel for what is going to happen. Now we will not discuss to that detail here, but to some level of detail we will discuss the effect of sinusoidal interference, which may be present in the receiver, and we will try to see how FM and PM differ from each other in the presence of these interferences. Which one is better? That is a natural question to ask, right? So we will try to address this question by looking at the effect of interference. And we will model the interference here as a single tone interference, that is a sinusoidal interference. So you can consider this discussion as some kind of a precursor to our discussion or to understanding the effect of noise on the FM system. So you only thing is our noise here is not a random signal, but a deterministic interference, sinusoidal signal of a different frequency. So let us consider the input, to either a phase to a PM demodulator or FM demodulator. or discriminator, what do you like to call it? What you are saying is that this input contains two parts. For the sake of discussion at the moment, I will ignore the modulations, right? Just otherwise the discussion becomes too complicated. Let us say you have your desired signal carrier frequency, of course along with the modulation and all that it carries, but let us just assume that we are ignoring the modulation, there is no modulation present, right. So it is, you know, it is slightly a tricky thing here, because FM is not a linear system, right. So its behavior with and without modulation would be slightly different, right, but broadly we can more or less. Also the fact that if I know the response to one and I know the response to the other, it does not immediately tell me what will be the response to the sum, because it is a nonlinear system. So we have to really go through the motions, and to keep the discussion simple, I am at the moment ignoring the modulation here. And let us say your interfering signal has an amplitude a sub I and has a frequency which is slightly different from the carrier frequency. Basically what we are saying is that your input RF filter and the IF filter bandwidth or whatever are not sufficiently good enough to reject some interfering signal which may be present close by to the desired signal, right. So there is a interfering signal close to your carrier signal, close to your signal of interest, and that seeps through the IF stage, that comes along with the desired signal through the IF stage, right. That is what we are trying to understand. So how will the FM discriminator respond to this kind of a signal? That is the issue. Suppose this is the output of the IF stage, right, how will the FM discriminator or the PM demodulator respond to this input signal? That is a question we will address and try to understand, gain some understanding. So we can write this as, how will you do this? We will do it exactly in the same way that we did the discussion for the AM signal. Convert this into a signal with some amplitude modulation and some phase modulation, and then proceed from there onwards. So we can write this in terms of quadrature components, AC cosine omega CT plus AI, expand this into cosine omega CT omega IT cosine omega CT minus A sub I sin omega IT into sin omega sub CT, which you can write in the form of an envelope or amplitude modulation R of T into cosine of omega CT plus phi of T. Alright. So see this. This is the input of the discriminator in the presence of interference, where phi of t, what is rt and what is phi t? Rt is, what is the in phase component? AC plus AI cosine omega I t this whole square plus AI square sin square omega I. Right, look at it from here, this plus AI cosine omega IT is the in phase component, AI sin omega IT is a quadrature phase component. And what is phi of T? That is tan inverse of A sub I sin omega I T upon A sub C plus A sub I cosine omega I T. That is standard, right, tan inverse of the quadrature component upon the in phase component is the value of the instantaneous phase. To keep the discussion, let us consider the discussion primarily again for the large signal to noise ratio, right. that is assume that your desired carrier frequency component A sub c amplitude is much greater than A sub I, the interference, right. Then we can simplify these expressions as, we can ignore this, essentially it becomes A sub c plus A I cosine omega I t, and phi of t becomes A sub I upon A sub c, we can ignore this term, into sin omega I t. In any case, it is not going to make any difference to our discussion here, so let us keep it here. You could if you wished, right, because your phase modulator, the phase demodulator or frequency discriminator is not going to be sensitive to R of t, right. So it is of no consequence. You are right, if you wished you could ignore this because A sub I is small. Here it is easier to ignore than here because there is a squaring involved here, right. So if you wish you can keep it, if you wish you can remove it, because it would not make any difference to our discussion from here onwards, right. So what will be your discriminator output? So we consider your phi of t as given by this. So discriminator output, by discriminator I mean frequency discriminator. Okay, let us say, let us use the discriminator in a more general sense. It could be phase discriminator or frequency discriminator. For the phase demodulation we will call it a phase discriminator. For the frequency demodulation we will call it a frequency discriminator. So let us say it is an ideal discriminator. So the for the phase modulated signal y sub dt would be proportional to the instantaneous phase deviation, right. So it will be the detector constant times the instantaneous phase deviation, and that is the instantaneous phase deviation, right. So k sub t into A sub I upon A sub c sin omega I t. So as you might expect, the output contains the interference, right. Of course it will come along with the modulation, along with the modulating signal m t, but I am ignoring the m t here, just looking at the effect of interference, right. How will the interference appear at the output of the demodulator? And I am doing this in the absence of the modulation, in the absence of, just looking at the effect of the interference alone, right. Since there was no message signal present, obviously there is no message signal present to the output, but output should have been 0. Instead of it being 0, there is a signal present, something coming from the interference, a signal coming at frequency omega sub I, right. So and its amplitude, its strength depends on the ratio A sub I upon A sub c, and if A sub I is small, which is what you assume, this will be a small interference. The output will, the discriminator output will show a signal, a spurious signal, which is not present in the input, desired input in this portion, okay. What will happen? So this is for the phase demodulator, for the PM case. What will you see in the FM case? You will see the derivative of this, right. An ideal discriminator will produce 1 by 2 pi k sub t A I by A c into d by dt of sin omega I t, etc. Okay, that is a good question. How did our tan inverse disappear? So basically we are ignoring which term? Yeah, we are using the approximation that tan inverse theta is approximately theta, right? For small values of theta, tan theta is theta, and therefore tan inverse theta is also the same. Tan inverse some x is also equal to x, right? Basically, we are using that approximation. Okay. So this becomes k sub d a sub I upon a sub c. There is an additional term constant here. The additional constant is this is 2 pi f I, 2 pi will cancel into f sub I sin omega I t cos, right. So one interesting observation that you may make here is, whereas the output amplitude for the of the output amplitude of the interfering signal at the discriminator output is constant for the case of a phase demodulator, it is a frequency dependent function for the case of frequency discriminator, right, for the frequency demodulator. That is, the larger the input frequency difference between omega c and the interfering signal, the larger the amplitude of the interfering signal at the discriminator output. The smaller it is, the smaller the amplitude. Of course, values of f sub i's which are greater than the bandwidth of the message itself will be of no consequence, isn't it? F I greater than w are of no consequence, because in any case you can put a low pass filter at the output of the discriminator to remove any higher frequency components, because your message signal contains signals only up to minus w to plus w. So if the interference signal exists at a frequency f I greater than w, that will be anyway removed. We do not have to worry. We only have to worry about f I's value of f sub i's which are between minus w and plus w, basically f I less than w, right. These are of no consequence. So what do we see? Suppose I summarize this behavior pictorially, what we are saying is the following. If I plot the amplitude of the output signal, discriminator output signal, which can be ascribed to the interference present at the input, that is due to the interference, versus the input signal input frequency, the input interference frequency, that is I am talking about f I, the interference frequency f sub I. For the case of PM, it has no dependence, right, it is a constant value. What is the value of this constant? This k sub d into a I upon a c, right. That is the behavior for phase modulator, phase demodulator. For the FM, it's a function like this, right? The amplitude of the output is frequency dependent. For smaller frequencies, the amplitude is small. For larger frequencies, the amplitude is large, right? So, FM seems to have an advantage as long as your FIs are less than a certain value, right? But if FIs are more than certain value, then PM has an advantage, right. The interference frequency, for higher interference frequencies PM has an advantage, for lower interference frequencies FM has an advantage, right. That is right, it is a sinusoidal interference. So as long as omega I is close to omega c, FM has an advantage. For omega I is far, sorry, omega c plus omega I close to omega c, FM has an advantage. Omega c plus omega I being far away from omega c, PM has an advantage. Of course, omega I or f sub I greater than w is of no consequence. We are talking of all these values lying between 0 to w. So for small f I, FM is superior. For larger values of f sub I, PM is superior. However, it is something that we would like to get the best of both the worlds if possible, right? So how can we do that? That is, we would like to retain the advantage of the FM signal which you get for the lower FI frequencies, but never exceed, let us say, what your phase modulator can give you. So I do not want to, I want to maybe accept this curve, but I do not want to take this portion of the curve, right. So what can I do, something so that I live with this disadvantage, but never allow the output amplitude to exceed what would come in the case of PM signal. Indeed, that can be done, but one has to use a filter at the output of the discriminator so that you get this kind of a behavior, right. If you use such a filter, which is called a de-emphasis filter, to emphasize larger frequencies. So let me take a fresh page. So we use a filter. Let us say a low pass filter, right. Basically, what do we want to do? We want to make sure that as the amplitude increases with frequency, the filter will reduce the filter response will be smaller at those frequencies proportionately, right. So the FM discriminator response is increasing like this. So I will allow the filter response to decrease linearly in the opposite direction, so that this becomes a constant, the product of these two becomes a constant, right. Such a filter, such a low pass filter will be what we call a de-emphasis filter, right. You de-emphasize the higher frequency components present due to the interference, right. You de-emphasize the higher frequency components. So by using a de-emphasis filter at the discriminator output, the effect of higher frequency components can be controlled, right. So typically you use a simple low pass RC filter.
But this will also affect the message.
Very good, of course it will, right. So we'll have to do something about that, right? But let me just come to that in a few minutes. So one typically uses a simple RC filter of this kind. The frequency response is like that. Choose the 3 dB cutoff frequency. Let's call this some value f sub 3, right? Which is somewhere here, right? So that when you combine this linear response with this linear response, this becomes a flat response like that, okay. A combination of this with this filter response gives you an overall response like this, and obviously the value of f sub 3 would be less than w, because we are anyway considering frequencies less than w, right. So choose an appropriate value of f sub 3, the cutoff frequency of this filter, right. So I do not know why I have used 3, you should simply say f sub c, cutoff frequency. Oh, that is the reason perhaps. So I think let it be f, there must have been some reason. So f sub 3 is less than w, right. Choose an appropriate cutoff frequency less than the bandwidth of the message signal, and there you are. But yes, as Rajat rightly pointed out, there is a problem here. The problem is that if the input signal has a bandwidth larger than this cutoff frequency, these higher frequencies will get attenuated. We do not want that to happen. We want the output to be a replica of the input. The filter should not distort the message signal itself. So what can we do about that? Basically, what are we doing? We are attenuating at the discriminator output the higher frequency components which may be present in the input signal, input message signal, right. So to take care of that, a simple thing that you can do is to put a compensation at the transmitter itself. You pre-distort the message, keeping in account, taking into account the fact that you are going to do this attenuation at the discriminator output, right. So you have a filter before you carry out your FM modulation, frequency modulation, you have a pre-emphasis filter which has the reverse or opposite characteristics of that of the de-emphasis filter, right. So to take care of, so this will lead to distortion of the message signal. And which can be avoided by using a suitable pre-emphasis filter at the transmitter before modulation, right. So for example, okay, we will start from here next time. Thank you very much.